Porcupines. They seem like such cute little animals, at least until you feel their spines yourself. But there's a surprise hiding in the history of these spiky little animals, one that is tens of millions of years in the making, and demonstrates well a common and important phenomenon in evolution, convergence. But first... just quickly, I want to take a moment to thank all of you for watching this video. I'm still such a small little baby YouTube channel that really every single view, every like, every comment really means the world to me. So thank you so much for watching. Anyway, on with the video. Porcupines are rodents, iconic for their spiky quills, modified hairs that are long and sharp and hollow and used by the animal to defend itself against predators, often with gnarly consequences for the would-be aggressor. According to National Geographic, a single porcupine can have as many as 30,000 quills, and can grow back more easily whenever it loses some. Now, spiky hairs for defense are not unique to porcupines. Other types of mammal, like hedgehogs and tenrecs and echidnas, also have them, but none grow spikes as long as porcupines do. In fact, some species of African porcupine can grow quills up to a foot in length. Now, there are either 27 or 28 species alive today, depending on how you count them. These are split into two different families and live all around the world, in Africa and parts of Asia, as well as in North and South America. Some of the African species have even been transported across the Mediterranean to southern Europe, which happens to be where some of the oldest fossil porcupines are from. Porcupines living in North and South America belong to one family in particular, the Erythizontidae. These are mostly tree porcupines, smaller animals that live up in the canopy of forests, where they forage for food and shelter from predators. Some of them even have prehensile tails that help them climb like a monkey's tail does. Their North American relative, Erythizon, for which the family is named, is a bit different. It's a larger animal and will spend lots of its life on the ground as well as up in trees. It eats lots of bark and young wood stems, as well as leaves and fruits. Sometimes it will even nest on the ground, living in crevices or burrows. Porcupines living in Africa and Asia belong to the other family, Hystricidae. These mostly live and forage on the ground, although one species in Asia, the long-tailed porcupine, does live up in trees and bushes. Porcupines are all herbivores and are usually nocturnal, meaning that they are active in the late evening and nighttime. When they are approached by a predator, they'll turn around so that their back and tails face the threat, with their quills pointing out towards it to fend off any attack. Now, some of you have probably heard that porcupines can actually shoot their quills, but that's actually a myth. The quills don't shoot out, but they do detach very easily when touched. Now, as porcupines are all rodents, and they all share this very specific adaptation for defense, it might be reasonable to assume that they're all very closely related, sharing a common spiky ancestor somewhere deep in prehistory that all of the modern porcupines evolved and inherited their quills from. But you'd be wrong. As we've already said, porcupines are mostly native to Africa and Asia, and to the Americas. Now, these two landmasses have been separated from one another for at least 65 million years. But the earliest fossil porcupines from southern Europe are only from around 23 million years ago, during the early part of the Miocene epoch, and they only appear in Africa and Asia later than that, during the middle part of the Miocene. The oldest fossil species that is a relative of the porcupine family in South America was found in rocks in Peru from around 28 to 33 million years ago, during the early part of the Oligocene epoch. But true porcupines only start appearing in the Americas later than that, again during the Miocene epoch, the same as in Europe and Africa. That means that there is a span of tens of millions of years between the two land masses that porcupines live on becoming separated, and porcupines becoming present on those two land masses. In an earlier video, we've talked about how rodents may have colonized South America from Africa, somehow crossing the Atlantic Ocean. But even this wouldn't explain the presence of porcupines in the Americas. The earliest fossil rodent known from South America, Caenonimus, is not a porcupine, and nor are the vast majority of the species descending from that lineage, which does include the Erythizontid porcupines.
This means that this likely isn't then a case of porcupines arising in Eurasia and then migrating directly to the Americas. Evidence from DNA analysis shows that the American Erythizontidae probably first evolved around 24 million years ago, while the Old World Hystricidae probably first originated around 21 million years ago, with their most recent shared common ancestor probably living sometime around 45 million years ago. Again, long after the so-called Old World and New World landmasses had become separated. With both fossils and DNA more or less in agreement about the timing of porcupine origins, and direct migration across the ocean seeming unlikely, we're left with only one reasonable conclusion. Spiky, quilled rodents must have evolved twice independently, once on each side of the Atlantic Ocean, and separated by at least 20 million years of evolution from their shared common ancestor. This represents a common and important phenomenon in evolution.
If you've made it this far in the video, then thank you so, so much again for watching. It really does mean so much to me when people, you know, watch and engage with these videos. But before we can keep going with it any further, there is another important concept that we need to get out of the way. And that is the concept of convergent evolution.
Convergent evolution is when two species have evolved to look very similar, sharing many common features of their anatomy, but without a shared common ancestor that they both inherited those features from. In other words, they have converged to the same point independently. We often tend to assume that species that look more similar will tend to be more closely related. The family resemblance was recognized by people long before the work of Charles Darwin and the theory of evolution by natural selection. In fact, when Carl Linnaeus was first working on what became the modern system of classifying species into related groups, he based his classifications mostly on physical similarity. The work of Watson, Crick, and Franklin on the structure of DNA revolutionized our understanding of genetics and heredity. It became clear that many species that looked very similar were in fact very distantly related. We think this usually happens when two lineages evolving either in different places or at different times happen upon the same solution to a similar problem. For example, being able to see is very useful for us. It helps us find food and detect threats, and more generally to interact with our environment more efficiently. This is a common theme for most animals, and so many animal groups have independently evolved sight. It's hard to tell exactly how many times this has happened, but it has happened multiple times. For example, in our own group, the vertebrates, as well as in arthropods like insects and crustaceans, as well as mollusks like snails and squid. Many more examples exist all over the world and across almost the whole tree of life. Look at wings, for example. Flight has evolved at least three times in vertebrates alone, in birds, bats, and pterosaurs.
Today, we've seen how porcupines and spiky hair have evolved multiple times in parallel across mammals, including two independent origins for porcupines. Convergent evolution will tend to produce the same adaptations if they are widely useful, like having defenses against predators is. And there are so many interesting cases of this that I plan on making an entire video series to document them. If you have any particular interesting cases in mind that you would like me to talk about, please put them down in the comments section and I'll get right on with it. Thank you for your time.